Yes, wonderful. So I'll give you 5 minutes.
Okay, that's great. First, I would like to thank the organizers, Luca and Sravan, for the possibility to participate in this nice conference. And it's really a very good time of scientific discussions during the pandemic. So the talk is based on my recent work in collaboration with Alexei Koshelev. And also I would like to thank other people who contributed to this business and discussion, very highlighting discussions with them, helped me to understand what's going on in non-local theories. It's Misha Shaposhnikov, Fedor Bezrukov, and especially Irina Arefyeva. So many thanks for the interest in this work. First, let me tell about motivation for studies of non-local theories. During this conference, there were said a lot of words about the possibility to quantize gravity, string field theory, and other motivations of non-local field theories. But I'm not a specialist in that topic, and I came to this business from cosmology and effective field theory, on which I worked in Moscow in the group of Valery Rubakov. So my point of view is a bit different from those presented in many talks before. For me, we often in cosmology we often deal with non-renormalizable scalar field theories because the potential of inflaton is likely to be non-renormalizable. Otherwise, it's not consistent with observational data. And we know that once the scalar field is non-renormalizable, loop corrections in general can generate all possible terms which are not forbidden by internal symmetries of the Lagrangian. So in general, we have Lagrangian of the form written here, which contains all possible terms and contractions of derivatives, if we consider just one scalar field. And these terms can contain up to infinite number of derivatives. All is there. Thus, all non-renormalizable scalar field theories are likely to be infinite derivatives. So this is a sign of non-locality. This is very hard to study, and we can extract any predictions in such kind of theories only for energies below the cutoff scale lambda, which stands in this Lagrangian. This example Lagrangian. But maybe there are any classes of theories which are good enough to produce to appear to be renormalizable instead of even containing infinite number of terms, they can still somehow be renormalizable and have self-healing mechanisms. Are there any classes of such a good theories? And it's clearly that if we have Lagrangian with non-local propagator, then this is such a theory which is held to be due to non-local propagator. The theory will be can be held to be even finite for a scalar field. Let me stress that in such kind of theory, the potential can be the potential is generic. It can be any. It's not phi cubed or phi to the four. It can be exponential. It can be have a really crazy form. No sign of renormalizability in a local theory, but just adding one propagator, one form factor in the propagator makes such kind of theory almost obviously renormalizable, and even UV finite. Actually, this is what we wanted in cosmology for studying inflation. In application to Higgs inflation model, first presented by Bezrukhov and Shabashnikov. It's a minimal inflation model, providing the early universe inflation stage, driven by the standard model Higgs field. This model is good in the sense of minimality because it doesn't require the appearance of extra degrees of freedom at inflationary scale. Everything is done just by Higgs field. But this model has a big disadvantage because it must have non-normalizable potential, and the cutoff scale of this theory is quite close to a Hubble scale of inflation, unfortunately is even lower than the scale of reheating in this model. And it provides a lot of troubles with description of when you want to consistently and carefully describe inflation and reheating, including quantum corrections. This problem can be easily healed also introducing a non-local form factor. And in my recent work with Alexey Koshelev, we did such kind of healing. The picture is because we did it in the COVID time. The blue line is three-level potential of the Higgs field non-local modification of propagator leads to the very possibility of computation of quantum corrections into this potential in the region, in the intermediate region of fields. So the problem to compute this line actually is that you can't even compute it in a local theory because you can't connect UV and IR parameters in this theory due to quite low non-renormalizability scale. So this is about motivation for studies of non-local scalar field theories. And then let me turn to more formal things regarding definitions of non-local amplitudes. During my studies of these non-local models, I heard a lot of, I met a lot of criticism from my colleagues working on cosmology and phenomenology, like how can you consider theories in which you can't do weak rotation? I turned closer to this point because for most of the audience here, I think it's more or less obvious, but for many people abroad, this community, it's still not obvious and not convincing. The model I consider further, which be even simpler, it is just a phi to the four model with a non-local propagator. To make this model UE finite, we need several properties of non-local propagator. It must be also, we don't want ghosts. That's why f of box must be exponent of entire function. To make UE integrals convergent, this function should fall fast enough in a Euclidean direction. And the normalization is f of n squared is unity. So let me show explicitly why the definition of integral in Minkowski space just by writing such kind of integral doesn't make sense. If you write this integral, the integral of this form, you can find that it is actually divergent. But my colleagues from other community normally asked me, why do you care? Because in all local theories, integrals also are divergent and you can renormalize them. But still, it's different things. In local theory, you can do weak rotation and connect Euclidean integrals with Minkowski integrals. And then you can make dimensional regularization and compute finally. In non-local theories, the point is that you can't connect Euclidean and Minkowskian definition of integrals just because the integral over this big circle is infinity. And here I clearly, I explicitly write down some simple formulas for which shows that this integral is actually infinity. It's very simple. It can be made zero only in only under very special integral condition applied to the function f of z. But this is only for tadpole diagram. So if I want this infinite circle to be zero for all loops, then I need infinite number of integral conditions that should be applied to the form factor function, which most likely cannot be satisfied. So the amplitudes have to be defined in a different way. It's very natural, and a long time ago, it was obvious for all old school people that amplitude should be written in for Euclidean momenta, and then analytically continued to Minkowski computed in Euclidean space, and then the result should be analytically continued to Minkowski external momenta. So you just change P0 component for all Euclidean momenta to IP0 for Minkowskian ones to have a physical result for the amplitude. And this way of definition of amplitude actually provides with unitary theory, which was proven by Ashok Sen. And here I just illustrate this proof on a simple model, just cutting the Fish diagram and finding its imaginary part. For this diagram, some poles are inside the contour of which is applied for, say, weak rotation in this case. And even when computing this integral, it's very important to keep both the Euclidean part of the integral and the pole part of the integral, which comes from the residues in these two poles. This integral over residues also contributes to the real part of the amplitude and provides an imaginary part of the amplitude, which for Fish diagram is exactly the same as it happens to be in the local theories, because you remember the condition f of m squared should be equal to unity. Then in the simple model for exponential form factor, exponent of box, the result can be obtained analytically. This computation was done actually, recently I learned that the result for the real part was obtained in the paper by Luca and others in 2018, and the result obtained in this paper perfectly agrees with those obtained in our recent work, which is of course very nice to see. So the result shows that in one side of for the physical momenta for p squared larger than zero, we have the exponential growth of the amplitude. For negative p squared, we have exponentially damped amplitude, and around zero, we have logarithmic divergence for massless case. And this is perfectly consistent with the local field limit, because local field theory limit, because when alpha tends to zero, we have to obtain the familiar logarithmic divergence. But the tricky thing in this case is the fact that that beyond non-locality scale, for momenta beyond non-locality scale, there is a strong coupling issue in such kind of a model. For example, if you want to take this total matrix element, this includes two crossings, and then if you want to compute, for example, forward scattering limit amplitude, you get the sum of two exponents, which both which is growing actually on the both sides of S plane. So everywhere for all S, you have growing amplitude upper than the locality scale. So does it make theory bad? The answer is no, because in this limit, one loop correction is not enough, and you must compute all loops to obtain the non-perturbative result. It's a tricky point whether it's possible. And for me, the good question for future study is to study the growth rate of diagrams with more loops with the exponential form factor and find which diagrams provide leading order in at high momenta, which grow faster, who is the fastest. Then probably these diagrams may be somehow resumed. But this is a difficult and tricky task, which is not clear if possible. Also, we studied other cases of the form factor F of box, which provides with a bit better results in which are free from strong coupling issues for at least for physical momenta. For generic F of box, you need to compute these amplitudes numerically. And the problem with this all these computations is that due to the presence of form factor, the familiar Feynman parameterization do not help and just increases the number of integrations. And direct computation works also bad because for numerics because it deals with complex arguments of form factor. And form factors normally, if you put exponent, then even it falls along the real axis, it would grow along the imaginary axis or some direction in a complex place. And if you need to take, for computing your integrals, need to take some value at the complex plane, then you can obtain a big number. And for numerics, it's very bad. You have to, one big number cancels another big number, producing a lot of mistakes. So in practice, it worked very bad. And for computing a particular Fish diagram, we used the coordinate space representation of propagator to compute this numerically because it allows to avoid going out of real axis in momenta. First, we divide the integral to pole part and Euclidean integral and Euclidean part, right, as this integral square of space of propagator in coordinate representation. We used two particular propagators. One is the exponent of box squared, which is a form factor of the form exponent of minus k to the 4, k to the 4. And here I set the non-locality scale to be unity. And the other form factor has more complicated form. First, it was written in a paper by Tombulis, and it is nice from the following point of view because it provides not exponential damping along the real axis, but power law decay. This concrete function provides with one over k to the four along the real axis. But as I showed on this plot, this is a modulus of this function for real and complex numbers. Here it's the real axis, and you see clearly that there are growth direction, and it grows very fast, faster than exponential, along some directions, making some computations, some numerical computations quite difficult. And these are our results. Let me show the Fourier images of propagator. It can be computed this way. And unlike the local case at around zero X, which corresponds to UV, it's they have finite values, both of the propagators. Local propagator would go to infinity here. And this is our numerical result for Fish diagram. For the exponent, we found that here it's hard to see, but we checked that the decay of this amplitude is exponential, and this one produces the Tombouli's function produces power law decay at high momentum. And anyway, we can see that for this choice of f of box, the amplitude stays small in all the physical region, and the model remains perturbative there. So we can compute and we can trust this computation because the first loop correction and other loops are supposed to be smaller. But of course, it should be proven more rigorously because the computations are really tricky and it's very hard to understand what is the growth rate of or decaying rate of non-local amplitudes, what is UV behavior of loop amplitudes.
Maybe 3 moments.
Okay, thank you. Then let me turn to discussion of implications of analyticity of non-local amplitudes. About the fact that amplitudes turn to be analytic in non-local theories, let me refer to the previous talk by Ashok Sen. It was told explicitly. For myself, I have to study all these works to convince myself that this is the case. Also, for the studies of UE behavior of non-local amplitudes, it could be quite useful to look at some old results like Martin Froissart bound for local theories. And recently it was shown that this result can be extended to non-local theories. Not exactly this result, but the result with another power of Mandelstam variable S. Should be valid for non-local series too, but under some analyticity assumptions which should be satisfied, and the most doubtful condition here is the exponential boundedness of the amplitudes for large S and Lemon ellipse. The amplitude should be exponentially bounded for this bound to be satisfied, but this is, of course, it's not obvious that it will work. But if we assume this, then we have polynomial boundedness or also for non-local series, which is quite, a very non-trivial conclusion. And it can be useful for example, for application of dispersive relations in this theory. Also, let me show the power of this approach in a simple example. Also, I need another old result for generic QFT obtained under the similar assumptions. The amplitudes in local theory cannot fall too fast. They cannot fast as fall as exponent. The crucial assumption of this constraint is the polynomial boundedness of the amplitude, which we actually obtained here, which was obtained in the recent paper by Junsei Takuda. Since we have the polynomial boundedness here, of course, remember that we have to assume that amplitudes do not grow very fast. Then we can conclude something about, for example, phi cubed theory without phi 4 term with the exponent of minus box squared form factor. Let's write the three level exchange diagram. It has this simple form. It has just a propagator here. This amplitude clearly falls too fast. Just comparing to this, looking at this Martin Serolus bound, and then it means that something is wrong with our assumptions listed here, and most likely the wrong assumption is that the amplitude is exponentially bounded. So it must grow faster than exponentially for some unphysical directions on the complex plane of S and for some complex values of T. And Interestingly, this result was obtained without any computations, which are hard to perform. And just comparing some generic results known about general field theories and working under several assumptions. So let me come to conclusions. Non-locality can make non-renormalizable theories renormalizable or even finite, which is a really good property of such kind of theories. And unitarity in these theories, if you define properly the Minkowski amplitudes in Minkowski space, if you define the procedure of computations, then you deal with unitary theory. Strong coupling issue can arise, and at the scale of non-locality for some choices of form factors, but for proper form factors, this can be avoided for at least for physical momenta. So there are theories which allows to perform computations and most likely trust the perturbative results. And these are directions for future study in non-local chiral theories. For me, it seems to be interesting to look at non-perturbative results with non-local form factors, which can be done in large n limit, large n resummations, to study more complex graphs, which might help to understand the UV behavior of loop amplitudes and how it is connected to the behavior of propagator, exponential or suppressed or power law suppressed. Developing techniques how to compute all these diagrams efficiently. The use of dispersive relations for non-local theories, and of course the big final purpose of all these studies is to build a consistent quantum theory of gravity and matter, which would provide with predictions for the real world, which are consistent with experiments and observations. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Thanks for an excellent talk, and you provoked a number of questions. Start with Harry. Go ahead.
We cannot hear. May I ask a question?
We cannot hear, Terry.
Yep, we cannot hear you.
Whom are you asking?
May I'm I ask you a question? Terry.
Go ahead.
May I ask a question?
No, we were asking, Terry Tobulis was first.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. First, I'm not sure what the problem is with, we know of course that continue from Euclidean Minkowski, only certain form factor will do. But if you take exponentials of even powers of the box, then you are always in good shape. For example, if you take e to the minus k to the k, you can analyze this as shown in great detail in a paper by Paul Chin and myself a few years ago in JHEP, that you can rewrite this in terms of generalized parameters and completely analyze how it behaves to any loop order. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that your statement of the results in this paper by Tokuda was not quite, complete or correct, because in that paper, of course, He doesn't assume any particular Lagrangian or Hamiltonian, but he makes some assumptions of exponential boundaries of certain Whiteman functions. But of course, the things are assumed, and therefore to derive about them, he says, I'm going to regularize, and he introduces what he calls the indicator factor, which is nothing more than kernels you would have gotten from scalar theories, for example, with the particular form of a kernel. And by choosing different kernels, of course, you can obtain different results. So his boundedness result for the forward amplitude holds only the amplitude is proportional directly to some power of t, the transverse Mandelstam variable, because when you take t, anything else than zero, exactly zero, even infinitesimal, he obtains a behavior that blows up. So that result of the forward direction is not a general result. But the point is that what he does is in no way different than what you get by using your scalar theories and choosing various forms of the form factors. These are my comments.
Okay, thank you very much for your comment. About the derivation of analog of Martin Froissart bound, up to my understanding, nothing about Whiteman functions is needed. It's what is needed only is the assumption of exponential behavior, of exponential boundedness.
Of the
Whiteman amplitude. No, on the amplitude. If you look deeply, we do not need to assume something about Whiteman functions in any particular theory. It could be somehow computed, but
I don't know what you mean.
I mean that
refer to this particular result from this particular paper. And if you go and read the paper, it starts with certain assumptions. The main assumption is exponential boundedness over the Whiteman functions, right? Nothing else. And then he, of course, starts from that. And then, of course, if you Fourier transfer them, that assumption implies extremely singular behavior, which has to be regulated.
Yes,
and it's explicitly regulated. And he puts in the regulators, which he calls the indicator factor, and then everything follows what he does, and he tells you explicitly, it all depends on my regularization. Different regularizations give you different results. It says all over the paper. So I don't know what you mean.
Well, I mean the part of the paper which relates, which is related to the derivation of the bound for the amplitude.
That amplitude is
the original formal proof, and
once you have the Whiteman functions, you can rewrite something like the time order correlation functions in terms of theta functions and the Whiteman functions. That's what he does. I mean, you have to read the paper, how he gets to that result, which, as he says, is totally regularization dependent.
Well, sorry, I read
maybe at this point we should move on to another question, because I think we are going in circles, Terry. And so why don't we postpone this and move on, because there are others who want to ask questions. Nikolai?
Anna, thank you very much for a very interesting talk. I have a question and a comment simultaneously. So in the original work of Efimov, it was proposed that it's very important to quantize the factor. So you can regularize the entire function and present it as an infinite sum of meromorphic, infinite sum of elementary propagator. A local propagator. I presented this formula in my talk. When you have a local propagator, it's no problem to calculate it in Euclidean or in Minkowski space-time. So you can calculate your, say, fish diagram using this regularization of form factor, and then you can remove regularization. And I guess you, I don't know, but I think you just reproduce correct result with so my question is that have you tried to do this such calculations?
Well, I haven't tried to do such kind of calculations because actually there were nice works by Shok-Sen proposing that there is a way of defining of amplitude through analytic continuation from Euclidean space, and this is unitary. But I think it might be the same, actually. The procedure would be completely the same as it happens in this approach. At least the method of analytic continuation of Euclidean integrals provides the results which has a good local limit. We do actually, in technically, we do the same as we did in local series. We just throw away the integral over a large circle, which here is infinity. But formally, we can do it in the same way it is done in the local theory. It would be the same as we continue from Euclidean to Minkowski with respect to the external momentum.
Let's take one last short question. Jens?
Yeah, thank you for the talk, Anna. And I have a very simple question. It's about Euclidean versus Lorentzian. So by Poincaré invariance, right, the green function propagator can only depend on the distance, four-dimensional distance squared. And you mentioned something about a propagator being finite at x equal to zero for this e to the box squared theory. So can you just clarify if this is for Euclidean space or if you're saying something about space-time? Thank you.
It was just technical thing for Euclidean space because I needed to compute in the Euclidean space. First, I did a kind of weak rotation correct way of defining amplitude. I got some pole part, included this, but then I am left with Euclidean integral, and just to compute it, I took the Euclidean Fourier transform.
Okay, thank you.
Great, so thanks a lot, Anna, for a wonderful talk. And let's move on to the last topic.